Hello, my name is K.K. Muhammad, the former Regional Director of Archaeological Survey of India. First of all, let me congratulate, very heartily congratulate Indian Museum Calcutta for organizing a lecture series during this lockdown period. The subject which I am going to discuss today and show you a small documentary is about the discovery of Akbar's Ibadat Khana. You all know that Akbar had invited people from all the religions, Hindus, Muslims, Christians, Jews, Jains and Parsis, into the hall of Ibadat Khana, and they discussed about the relative merit of each religion. Akbar listened to them very carefully, closely questioned them, but remained uncommitted. As a result of the discussions at Ibadat Khana, he evolved a new religion known as Deen-e-Ilahi, which is rightfully considered as the nursery of Indian secularism. But now the question is, where is this Ibadat Khana? What is the location of it? A group of historians said that it is among the standing monuments of Fatehpur Sikri. But another group said, no, it's not among the standing monuments. Long back it had fallen down. It is now completely buried. It is in the shape of a mound. And here exactly comes the role of an archaeologist. How archaeology can finally give an answer to these two questions? That is the thing which we are going to see in this particular video. Please watch it and enjoy it, for it gives you a deep insight into the methods of archaeological explorations and excavations.
This mosque, the tomb of Salim Chishti, and the palaces are reminiscent of a rich and colorful history. The shifting of the capital from Agra to Fatehpur Sikri and the erection of the Rang Mahal, tomb and palaces reflects the implicit faith of the King Akbar in the power of the Sufi saint Sheikh Salim Chishti. The unprecedented victories in almost all the battles he fought with, coupled with the birth of a child after the prophecy of the Sheikh, further strengthened his faith in Islam. Now, in order to learn more about various aspects of Islam, he started a debating hall known as Ibadat Khana, in which Islamic scholars of repute were invited to enlighten the king. But to his utter shock and dismay, strong and violent arguments among the Muslim scholars created doubt in his mind about Islam alone being the true religion. Gradually, it jolted him out of faith in Islam. But being a spiritual man, religion and philosophy always rankled in his mind. To calm down the spiritual turmoil in him, he now started looking towards other religions. Ibadat Khana was now thrown open to people of all religion, Hindus, Christians, Jains, Parsis, Jews came to the hall of debates and put forward their point of views before the king. The discussions at the Ibadat Khana among the scholars of various religions led to the culmination of a new religion known as Deen-e-Ilahi. By sheer merit, it has entitled itself to be the proud nursery of Indian secularism. The question of the location of Ibadat Khana was agitating the mind of Mr. Muhammad when he visited the site as a young member of the National Excavation Project.
The location and identification of Ibadat Khana
has always evaded a final answer. Most of the scholars identified it among the standing structures of Fatehpur Sikri, widely differing in their own identification. V.S. Smith was a very renowned historian. He has identified the single chambered pillar with a circular platform and with the radiating causeways as Ibadat Khana. The next generation of scholars like Percy Brown, who also worked on Fatehpur Sikri, said this is that the single pillar chamber is Ibadat Khana. But Sayyid Ahmad Mararavi was a scholar. In 1906, he said, it is not among the standing monuments of Fatehpur Sikri. It is completely fallen down and completely buried also. And he identified an unpretentious mound in between Jama Masjid and Jodhabai Mahals as Ibadat Khana. But however, he had no proof for in support of it. When Athar Abbas Rizvi and Flynn came, they also supported Sayyid Ahmad Mararavi's that unpretentious mound is the Ibadat Khana.
Mr. Muhammad sought to understand the location of it on the basis of the literary descriptions given by the contemporary historians of Akbar's time, such as Abul Fazl and Abdul Qadir Badawi, both of whom participated in the discussions itself. Armed with this data of the authentic Persian primary sources, the entire area was explored, and through the process of elimination, all the sites were rejected, except the one proposed by Mararavi. The selected site for the excavation, the ground zero, was still in the shape of a mound. Further, it was surrounded by a boundary wall with few broken arches on the western side. It was this boundary wall and the broken arches which gave Mr. Muhammad the first brainwave or definite clue about this mound being the site of Ibadat Khana. He vaguely recalled an Akbarnama painting of Ibadat Khana, painted during the lifetime of Akbar.
I had seen this painting in many of the published books, especially the one written by Edward MacLagan about Jesuits and the Great Mughals. The mother copy is in Chester Beatty Collection, Dublin, which was looted by Nadir Shah in 1739 when he attacked Delhi Fort.
That painting of Ibadat Khana, painted 3 years before the death of Akbar, bears resemblance to the site, which is standing in stone and lime before him.
It was a moment of unbelievable excitement for me. I am on the verge of the discovery of Ibadat Khana, my inner soul whispered. Once this thrilling realization dawned upon me, then that desolate mound, covered with the earth of 400 centuries and also overgrown with a number of trees, became full of life and activity. The fact that I was standing on the birthplace of the nursery of Indian secularism, that is Din-e-Ilahi, Akbar, the most argumentative Indian coming to this particular place, and the scene of the intellectual tussle of an age, gave me further strength to excavate the place in 2 years. When an area of 5 meter into 5 meter was excavated with meticulous care and precision, to my great surprise, a lower platform and a middle platform could be exposed. The result was very encouraging. So it was decided that the excavation would be further extended north-south and east-west also. But before extending it, there were a number of trees still growing over that one that had to be removed. When the excavation was further extended, it could again expose 3 platforms, the lowest platform, the middle platform, and the third platform. The third platform was further divided into 2, the front portion and an antechamber.
Mr. Muhammad, a simple question from a layman. Where is the flight of steps which facilitates access to the monument?
That was agitating my mind also. Then we explored the entire area and we apprehended a site. When we excavated the bottom part of the first platform, there we could get the flight of steps.
This means you have been able to excavate a structure at Fatehpur Sikri
yes.
with three platforms,
yes.
a flight of steps,
yeah.
a boundary wall, and few broken arches. But you have not been able to prove that this was the Ibadat Khana. Do you have any tangible proof for that?
Yes, of course. Because, you know, the tangible evidence comes from the Mughal painting. The painting of Ibadat Khana, which was painted during the lifetime of Akbar, under the personal supervision of Akbar by his own court painter known as Narsingh, also shows three platforms. So the first platform, that is the lowest platform, has been occupied by different scholars. The middle platform that has been occupied by, one can very easily identify Abul Fazl, Faizi, Father Rudolf Akaviva, who had come from Italy to participate in the first religious discussion, and Father Monserrat, who was a Spanish man, and he had also written a book known as Mongolic Irrigationist Commentaries. The third and top platform have been occupied by Akbar himself. So when we excavated the lowest platform, that measured almost 21 meters, the middle one, that is 13 meters, and the third one, that is 4.5 meters. And in the back, I mean, just behind where Akbar was sitting, there was a door was also shown, and very fortunately in the excavations, we could get the stone on which the door frame stood.
The comparison of the Mughal painting with the excavated structures proves the veracity of the discovery. In the painting, one can see the boundary wall, and very fortunately, this boundary wall was already existing. The painting also shows a step to provide access to the platforms. We have been able to excavate that particular step also. Again, the painting shows three platforms, 1, 2, 3. And we have been able to excavate all the three platforms. The third platform has further been divided into two, making it a front portion and an antechamber. The excavation of the top platform also has given a similar front portion and an antechamber. On the western side, there are three arches. It was these three arches, the boundary wall, and the dome behind that had given the first clue about the site being the possible site of Ibadat Khana.
16th century was a period of religious extremism and persecution all over the world. In the massacre of Warsaw and Bartholomew, a number of persons were butchered for their religious beliefs. Shias were pursued and persecuted in Sunnis Turkey. Sunnis had to flee from Persia, but peace with all religions prevailed in Akbar's India. Even when there was sporadic attempt by extremists to break the peace, Akbar's administration suppressed it with a heavy hand. Religious extremists all over the world refused to accept a liberal mind like Akbar, and this feeling is aptly captured in those lines of Akbar Allahabadi. Ye zahide tang nazar ne mujhe kafir jana, kafir ye samajhte hain ki musalman hoon main.